Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
So, you have accepted the truth.
I've accepted the truth that you were once Anakin Skywalker, my father.
That name no longer has any meaning for me.
It is the name of your true self you've only forgotten.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Ben Edward Hopper Fowler, with Tim William Alexander Hannon, Will Bob Ross Heim, and Ryan Jackson Pollock Sawaski. Brett Salvador Dalarenko was not invited to today's podcast.
As it should be.
That's right.
As God the creator.
I mean, there are no mistakes, but...
We don't need your drooping clocks here, Brett.
Happy little accidents.
Just like me.
This week on the STABcast, conventions everywhere are canceled. Oh. Lots of battle reports. We look at painting, that thing that sometimes people do, and a few more things. Just a few more.
Good news, everybody. I got my degree.
Hey!
Jose.
I submitted the last paper literally Thursday night before we recorded this podcast at 11 o'clock in the evening.
Tim, it pop the champagne.
Cue the yub nub.
Already been there for a while, but all right. Yeah.
Officially.
Okay. Officially. Now you have a reason to.
Round two of mimosas. So. Here we go.
Yeehaw. Now,
that being said, I've yet to play a game.
Yeah,
I played a game like 3 weeks ago before Thanksgiving, but I'm a little worried about COVID between now and Christmas. I'm going to go see my dad. He's had a health concern, so a little worried about getting out there. In fact, I dipped a tournament this weekend for that same reason. So,
yes. Well, I mean, the tournament also dipped us, so it's cool.
Well, that's also true.
That's also true.
we canceled dipped it first, though.
Yeah, exactly.
It made the hard decision for us. Yep.
We did it first. We did the brave thing.
Yes.
So, unless I play with this pod of podcast crazy people, I probably won't get any more games in before New Year. But I'll try.
That's fair. Yeah.
I mean, you're welcome to my table.
You're my pod. You're my pod, people. I do need to actually get to your house. Meet the cat.
You can play against my rebels. Table.
I can invite people over now that I have a floor that's not stained with dog love.
You don't have to go into detail about what happens in there.
But Tim, you don't want to actually introduce this to your mother.
No. No, I don't.
She's a fine lady.
Tim's mom is in for the holidays. She's going to be here till the new year.
Yes, she is.
So, Tim and Mrs. Tim are struggling a little bit.
No, it's fine.
Why would there
be
any
struggle? Cast. That's a different cast for a different time. And that cast is called therapy.
I thought that was your job.
But who watches the Watchers, Will?
No one. Yeah, that's kind of the problem,
Tim, I
right?
thought we were your therapist because you don't trust other therapists because you are a therapist.
I mean, you're not
Tim
wrong.
Tim doesn't trust us.
You're also not wrong. Now we're seeing the root of the problem. Here we go.
Ryan, don't put us in your collective group of the STABcast.
Also true. So, yeah, I play no games. But, Tim, did you play any games?
I was going to say, part of the problem with the trust issues is when you go to a friend's house, you say, hey, let's play some Legion. It'll be fun. Let's have a good time. Let me try out these new points that came out. And you go,
go out to the coast. Legion.
You hang out. And then all of a sudden, you wake up and your pants are around your ankles. You're sore. You don't know what happened. You're a little upset, but a little surprised, a little happy, and mostly sad. And you just don't
It sounds
know.
Like he hasn't even noticed that I took his kidney.
I did, but I didn't care because it's clone. So what can you do but give it to them? That's fine. I went to Will's house the other day and we played, and it was a game of Legion that happened.
It was. I played a janky Republic list.
Yeah. What did you bring, Will? Go ahead.
Well, I wanted to try out Anakin. And I also wanted to play out a Clone Wars episode. So I brought Anakin. I brought Anakin, Rex, Padme, R2-D2.
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. Welcome to the quad hero team. It's more fun here.
It is kind of fun. Then I had two phase twos with Z6s, two naked phase ones, and an arc team with fives.
That sounds like plenty.
It was plenty.
It was nine acts.
Plenty. Yep.
I was before the game, I was breaking it down, and it was like, so all of these troopers over here have 23 wounds, and these four characters here have 22 wounds.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's a thing that happened.
Yep.
This is why five should be more expensive.
There's many reasons why five should be more expensive, but...
He's only 5 points more than a sniper rifle for me.
Oh my god. Stop it. And I also had 9 activations. I wanted to try this out. I saw this mentioned and I wanted to see if it could be viable. And there's a chance for it. But it was Vader with throw, saber throw, force push, and barrier. Ooh, double dubacks with the 5-point gun. Haha, now it's 5 points. 5-point crit gun and tenacity, because we don't need endurance with Papa Vader around. So that's fine.
It's true. It's true.
Roger. Roger.
And I deleted the list already out of anger, so I'm going off my menu.
You had 3 stormtroopers with DLTs and 3 stormtroopers with medbots.
Thank you. 3 stormtroopers with DLTs, 2 snows with the meds, which actually worked out quite well. And yeah, then
those are great med carriers.
Death trooper with the new DTF. It's not new DTF, but the updated DTF. Okay. And she was quite good. They were quite good. Yeah. Actually, I don't think the DTs ever took damage. So that was
no, I did not bother them. they because they did not bother me.
You know, they tried
to. They suppressed me.
They tried to. They shot some shots and
went to short range config and it.
Yep.
It rolled.
It rolled. I rolled 6 hits and you rolled 6 blocks.
That was that.
But yes.
Only after surging and dodging.
No, that was your natty one.
No, that was the Dubek. Anyway.
Oh, sorry. There were a couple of rolls, ladies and gentlemen, where I rolled really well, and then Will was like, let me also roll well, naturally. I don't even need to spend my cool tokens.
Parry this, you casual.
Yes, it was exactly that.
Oh, man. I do believe in the group text, Will does say something to the effect of, or maybe Tim does, that not a single surge token was spent.
Yep, that's exactly right. But yeah, and we played advanced positions, key positions, and rapid reinforcements.
So many positions.
We did.
Yes. So many positions. It was
they weren't fortified positions, though.
No,
man. Yeah. Oh, that's too bad.
That would have been
triple position.
Triple. Yeah, it would have been. That would have been nice.
It was interesting. Had some. Our key positions were pretty close to each other. So like
they were.
Everyone was in the thick of it within round one. Which
but that's probably good for Dubacks, am I not wrong? Or Vader.
Well, we'll get there in a second. So.
objectively speaking, just on the like
in close. Theory.
At the end of round one, I was down a squad and almost 2 squads, and he was down 1 model. So wasn't
2
great.
Clones, sir.
Two clones.
If I may ask, what did you guys rapid reinforce? I'm always interested in this one because it's the one I always feel
it's a very valid question, especially on this. It's a very, very good question.
Yeah, especially with those lists. Yeah.
Yeah.
I rapided my full arc team.
Ooh. Giving up because... a turn one shot with them.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I knew that on turn one they'd be approaching and they don't get a tactical aim token anymore. So I was like, let's try this out. See if I need to rapidly be somewhere important.
Oh, it works so well. I find
that's kind of gutsy because your bag doesn't help you with that.
No, yeah, no, true. I pulled
if you actually
them.
Draw that.
I had improvised on Padme and my first bag pull was them. And I had to improvise.
Yep.
That's why you bring
it. But I was like, 5 points worth it.
Oh, yeah. Improv at 5 points is juicy.
The middle objective was a large turbo laser turret, and so it was line of sight blocking. So he could just plop them behind the line of sight blocking, and they were fine.
Next to Rex. They were just hey, Rex, how's it going? Let's split up and go around this thing and kill everything.
It's what ARC troopers do. They just appear from, the heavens and then do stuff.
Just thematic. I'll give you that.
I rapid reinforced my second Dubek. Just one of them.
Because he had to deal with a certain trash can.
Yes, the trash can. And that's what I was going to lead into.
Because R2 on key positions is even more dumb.
Yeah. I had to deal with R2. And he, being advanced positions, he was all the way in the corner. So I had to put my Dubek even farther in the corner to deal with him.
I love that you sent a garbage truck after the garbage can.
Yes. Well, and listen.
It's escaping. I want to model a stormtrooper riding the backside of it like he's a garbage
can. And the garbage truck dumpstered the garbage can. Like, I mean, I went around the corner and I one-shotted R2 with the claw attack. It was great.
He meleeed me, he got 4 hits, and I blanked it, and he was dead.
Yep. But the problem was not that. The problem was now my Dubek is halfway across the map. More than halfway, really.
Yep.
So the Dubek spent most of the rest of the game trying to get to relevance. he
mattered at the end of the game.
He did matter at the end of the game. Not to super fast forward here, but Rex is also hiding behind that line of sight blocking turbo laser. Dubek came up behind him and was like, rawr, rawr, and Rex survived with 1 hit point. And so because he was in melee and that's how that goes, he lived. And that actually was a big game deciding factor.
It was.
Yeah, it was.
But we were mostly playing around that big turbo laser where we'd kind of like poke out to shoot past it at each other.
Well, and no, you would shoot. I would just evidently, I guess I was just shooting into the wind. I don't know what I was doing.
I would poke out. And round one, I did poke out with a Z6 phase two, and I just killed an entire Stormtrooper squad that was just in the
wipe.
Open.
Total wipe. It's boom.
I got 7 hits, and then he rolled 2 blocks, which meant 5 wounds went through.
Yep.
Which was a squad.
Yep.
That was a squad wipe.
Sounds like bull.
Yes.
Vader was there.
Vader was there. The snow medics actually kept Vader alive for while.
You healed 3 off of Vader with those medics.
Oh, wow.
And awesome. More importantly, they kept him alive long enough to where it was a super, super bold play, but we both had to play really boldly here because towards the end of the game, Vader and Anakin were face to face and both were hurting. I played Implacable, so I had to heal him. Last activation of the turn before was a medbot to heal Vader. Played Implacable the next turn. Played Vader. Took a swipe at Anakin. Anakin had, 2 health left, something like that, 3 health left?
Yes.
And then took 1 wound back onto Vader, so Vader was back down to 1 health. And it was basically just playing who draws their leader first. Who wins?
Right.
Who wins this? And I got to pull Vader first, long story short, there.
Nice.
Vader did strike down Anakin. Yeah, it was a good time. That was fun. That part was good. Vader was fun, but Vader did the Vader problem, and this is my lament, is, first off, couldn't block for anything. Couldn't save
his life. He really couldn't.
And even some of his attack rolls were meh, because he doesn't surge. No surges. He's like, eh. Like, I rolled some great surge attacks, and he's like, oh, nothing. And again, rolled some great blocks with surge results. Nothing.
I know, theoretically, the red dice shouldn't hit all those surges, but I've been there.
Oh, yeah. Well, it just does. Yeah.
It just does. But then also the other problem, too, with Vader is Vader's great. But what's the rest of his list doing?
Barrier
definitely saved a Dewback for a turn long enough to get into melee. So Barrier came into play, but I don't know if Barrier makes up for the entire cohesion that a traditional commander brings.
I think we talked about how it's probably worth it to get up to Palp.
Yeah.
So let me ask a dumb question. How often do you tend to activate Vader early in your list?
It depends on the terrain. It depends what we're looking at. So in this game, I activated him early normally to get him behind line of sight, because if I didn't, he was going to get shot by the entire clone army. So I had to activate first, otherwise he's dead.
He did have to duck out of a fire support I set up.
Yeah. So normally I try to hold off.
Died.
Yeah, could normally I try to hold.
Now that it's 5 points, if you can go a little earlier with Vader, does guidance find a place on Commander Vader?
I think the problem is not that guidance is bad on him, because you're right, is you're starting to go a little earlier with him. The problem is that there's those 3 slots are so valuable.
It's opportunity cost, absolutely.
Yeah, you can't get rid of Barrier. Barrier's got to be staple on him because he's saving people next to him.
Right, but
you don't really have a
place to throw aggressive tactics anywhere, and until we get something with bolster, because you're not really running double commander where somebody else can take a 15-point command upgrade when Vader's cards don't really tend to order that many things.
Right.
But getting 1 or 2 surge tokens, even just 1 surge token on him, could be pretty killer.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I do wonder, as much as I hate OP Vader, I wonder if the points drop pushes me towards OP Vader a little bit more so I can run another commander with him. But I think as is right now, I agree with Will, because this is what I said initially, is you spend a little bit more just to get up to Palp, and you're now basically getting a whole nother activation with Palp as well, for pull the strings. So it...
True.
Yeah, I think...
But you are spending 30 more points to get that second activation.
I mean, yeah, but that's the 30-point activation that sometimes tends to be your heavy hitter. I like Palp Bosk. So now I'm paying 30 points to have a Bosk shoot again. I'll take that. That's fine. But Vader did some neat things. Vader's Might whiffed it completely. So it's great.
Oh, that sucks.
I moved the ARC troopers. I was like, maybe we can get some easy kills on the ARC troopers, and God said no. So
yeah, I mean, I kind of get that. Like, I don't know. For me, Vader's might is really spooky. Not so much like the damage is the gravy. Like, if you can get it done, for me, it's all about shoving someone off of an objective or out into the open. It's more about the geometry rather than the probability.
Yes, I did both. You can actually do both. It's great.
You can. No, you can. I agree. Yes. But like I said, I value more one over the other.
The problem is when Vader's might came up the first time that Tim and I played it, he got that beautiful roll that wiped out a squad of B1s.
Yep. So now
yep. And so it's never his expectations have been really high.
Well, and it's B1s. Yeah, and it's B1s.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the dice are the dice. But yeah, it was all these B1 droids explode.
No, push
this was 5 white dice, so there should have been probably 1 or 2 wounds. But yeah. There were none.
There were a lot of close rolls on that game that, if they swung a little bit differently, it would have been it would have come down to kill points.
So. Mm-hmm. But, mm-hmm. And we played on a timer, so we only got to turn 4.
Yeah.
But if we kept going, I would have probably wiped him.
It would have just gotten worse.
To double move my guys to the middle point on turn 4, but if I hadn't had to, I could have just kept setting up and killing everything.
Yeah, if it was a tournament setting, we would have done to 5, because we could have rushed through 4.
Yeah, but we were just here, and I was like, I need to know if this is the last turn, too. Yeah, and it was like 8:45, we're like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah. That was close, but at the end of the day, it wasn't close at the same time. Like Will said, like one more turn, and that close game becomes a lot less close all of a sudden.
Wait, did Will shut his house down at 9 o'clock?
No, we started.
Is that my habits? It's the Waltianisms in him.
We started the timer at 7, and it was
okay, gotcha.
It was like, we have 15 minutes, so we just need to call it, because I don't want to be like, well, there's 2 minutes on the timer now. Right. You know.
I mean, that's how you play competitively. Yes. But yeah, it's I wanted to go to bed and just cry, so I wanted to go home. The big deciding factor again was a couple of rolls, but then also that dewback being all the way in the back, because if that dewback wasn't there, he would help tear up that line. But
yeah,
having the one dewback in there has the one dewback problem that I always talk about, is that they get focused down too easily. And again, my dewback whiffed the roll and just got murdered.
Yeah, I want to roll off when we both played a 2-pip. He played New Ways and I played Take That Clankers.
Yep.
And so my ARC team got a full 11 die attack into him that rolled like
11. It was all 11.
No, it was 10. I had one.
You got a couple of hits that were all 11 hits. I remember that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's normal.
That's all of them. That's all of them again. Look at that.
That just happens. Yeah.
The fact that you said that's normal is the sign that that's
I had a Z6 naturally roll 8 out of 10.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I sent it to Ryan and said, why aren't your Z6s this good?
Yeah, but anyway, it's not broken at all, guys. Not broken at all.
Yeah, I can't share surge tokens.
I know.
I didn't spend any. I just rolled it.
Yeah. Imagine if you could share dodge tokens.
I spoke a little bit longer on that one because it was interesting, but at least it's 2 battle reports in 1, so it's okay.
Anakin is weird, but I like him.
Yeah, that's fair.
I played him with choke and reflex and endurance, and endurance kept it to where he never got to play Anakin's flaw card.
Oh, that's kind of
interesting.
Now, is that because Tim couldn't shoot at the thing, or because you had enough inspire in other places? Or
no, I just never had. I would have to end a turn with 3 suppression, and because I always had dodges, Tim didn't want to take the wounds to suppress him.
Right.
Oh, that was crushing.
I had Padme dodges.
Oh my gosh. That was the crushing thing, is that with dodges 24/7, it's anything you do to Anakin is going to make me die.
Yep.
is bad.
And so Brett disagrees with me, but I really think Anakin's 3-pip is very important.
Yes.
Turn 1.
Because it allows him to be not just a beat stick. He can kind of chill and be like, here's some stuff, everybody.
Yep. Yeah. He's a battery until the battery explodes. Boom.
Yeah, like one turn I just jumped down, took a free dodge, and then took an aim action, and then I was like behind line of sight blocker, so I was just like, you guys spend these.
Yep, it was great.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
Because Brett and I talked about it, and he's like, well, I don't want them taking Anakin's tokens, and it's like, they don't have to, but if they can, it's a nice option.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And honestly, for a 3-pip on turn 1, you still get to order 2 other units. Yes. Like, you have a nice setup there.
Yeah. Well, 3, because 5s let you coordinate to another one after that.
I mean, the only time in this particular list that you won't be able to do that is if you really want to divulge. Padme's right. card, which that was the I don't one, think right. I've ever seen I, you do. So
I've done it twice now on boxes.
Okay.
Yeah, I can see that.
But I maybe should have to make Tim even more upset to try to double secret mission him on key positions. So that even if he had two of the three, I could still say I have 3 points.
Yeah.
But then Tim might have just left.
That's the danger of KP. Yeah, yep. That's the danger.
I think Tim would have just gone home.
I did go home.
That's well, earlier. Maybe yeah. It would have been more merciful, maybe. I don't know.
7:15. Well, I'm putting my models away. Thank you for this, right. for this lovely tour of your home. I'm out.
But then again, right. you don't want a secret mission into Double D-Pack. That seems like a bad idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because she probably also would have been taken care of by the...
With your only white save models on the table.
Yeah.
But again, that's the problem with R2-D2, is that if you don't take care of him, he's going to sit over there and score a point.
Yep.
I mean yeah, it is. But I think as we're learning, and as easy for Rebels, and I think Tim found a cool Tim solution, get the bugger up in melee. Get him and get short-range weapons. Like, he's the unit where short-range weapons are good against, because, like, you can't hide from me if I can only see 6 inches. Mm-hmm. So having a melee unit in your army just to deal with R2-D2 may not be a bad thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, send your operative Luke after R2-D2.
I've actually found another unique way to deal with R2-D2, which makes me very happy.
Do tell.
Wedge Antilles and a ground buzzer.
Yes. But where would you have learned Ryan?
Zoning everything out of your back arc shot. I have been playing, I think I played 7 games this week. Brett's been a great practice partner on TTS. I got 2 games in at our last local Wednesday. I've been playing a lot of Legion. This points update, the not or lack of kind of was bumming me out a bit. And so I kind of take a step back and the fire had been tamped. But now that all these interesting new creative ideas are out there, I've been having fun, and I've been toying around with 2 lists, but the one that I've been having the most fun with has definitely been the T-47, the X-34, Han, Chewie, R2, and it's been an absolute delight to play, because it plays so different than anything else I've played in a long, long time, where your orders go and what range mans you try to focus on. And it's not just like, let's seize the middle objective, score as many points as we can before I get beat back and survive on 2 models, which is pretty much how I've played up until this point, now that I actually have some durable speeder units. So, and the other cool thing is the list has a full commando team in it.
It does.
Now, so I watched you play this one night while I was typing a paper. Mm-hmm. I had y'all on one side listening to y'all talk while I was writing something up. And Brett beat the tar out of you. Like the ever-living daylights. Like, Now, part of it was dice. He diced well. Part of it was approach.
He diced well. That was also the first game I had ever played against Anakin. And I made some missteps, and there were some pretty big dice swings pretty early. Like, I just couldn't knock the clone troopers off the board. Anakin wasn't the problem. It was just like, well, I got this aimed X-34 shot where I get to roll a billion dice. Let's see what happens. Oh, I got 8 hits. Oh, you dodge, roll everything off, spend 2 surge tokens, and take no damage. Neat.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened, in fact. So what lessons did you learn when you when you finally got to the ground buzzer delight?
So I learned that playing with these double heavies, in my opinion, the 2 big keys to the list are Han has improvised orders and R2 has a comms relay. Han doesn't always need to be in the speeder. That was one of the big misplays I made against Brett, is I got Han in there too quickly and I didn't have an answer to deal with Anakin, and Anakin just kind of cut Han into little bits before he could earn his points back. Because really against clones, like Han loves to play against clones. Han hates to play against droids. And because against clones, you know, you shoot Han's gun 4 times and he's gotten his 100 points back. Like, you get 2 attacks off and you're getting close. Oh, so,
yeah.
And so that was a misplay I made against Brett, and learning just how the spatial awareness works. But Han with improv and R2 with the comms relay is a great way to get my orders to my heavies when they need to go. Because R2, I don't think, ever took an order for himself. He always, like, I run R2's one pip card, Blastoff, in there, because the Blastoff text is neat. But he can throw that order to the X-34, which I tend to keep my R2 fairly close to. It gives him, another threat when something's running down. R2 gets that suppression token. You now have to shoot the, invincible land speeder rather than the trash can. And he can keep it ordered up. And between that and improvised orders, I can pretty much control when my heavies move. And I found the problem, the way to solve Anakin. Not solve Anakin, but a great way to deal with him is, Tim, our snipers are pretty rad against Anakin. I'm not going to lie. That high true. Velocity to where yep. he can't spend those dodge
I did
tokens,
think about
and
that.
You have and the sharpshooter.
Yeah, as much as I don't like snipers, I was like, I could see it being viable against Planikin, Bananikin.
Because even if you're not obviously getting to use the sniper's biggest boon, which is the Pierce, mm-hmm. You are getting, because it has sharpshooter, he's not going to get that free cover that he could just mitigate some damage on.
Right.
But you're making him take suppression. And if nothing else, your sniper against Anakin becomes that suppression gun, which is... And also, Chewie's a pretty good counter to Anakin because, oh no, you reflected one wound back at Chewie. Whatever shall I do? Oh no.
Right. Oh no, not the one so wound.
Yeah, like droids and rebels probably don't care as much as Tim did, but he didn't have many things that he could easily throw away.
Take a sacrifice, yeah.
He's like, I don't want to lose a DT.
I will say, this is the thing. Okay, well, so this is, because you're about to talk about where you did the same list against Will. And this is the thing that I have always struggled with in Legion, because games are harder for me to get in, is playing the same list over and over again.
Yeah,
I know it's because you're a tournament tryhard. That's fine. Mm-hmm. That's your lifestyle. You like to lead it that way. I have a hard time. Partially, it's like, oh, I've done this before.
Yes.
And so, I mean, there's always lessons to learn in that. And so... It's not a bad thing. That is something that's a difference in our personalities. That's why we bring the four of us together in this podcast.
Right.
So you, dear listener, can hear those differences. Because I struggle with that. But that does mean sometimes I don't know how my list works as well as I probably should.
You can hear the three of us be right and Ryan. And then you can decide what you want to do with that information. And
well, you see. So before the points update, I had played the same clone list for about 2 months. Just because it was in my box and I liked playing it.
Yep.
No, but I agree, Ben. Like, that's always my problem for being more competitive versus just having fun, because I just want to try all these cool lists, and what about how I try this? But you get better.
Tim and I are very
it.
Much that way. It's like, well, I'm going to pull this out of my box, and we'll go try
it's
this
the two
thing.
Sides
and
fighting.
With the new points update, it's good to try to get whatever you can on the table and be like, how's this feel now? But before that, I was just like, this is good. I'm going to play it.
And that was my original plan, was like, I want to put Wookiees on the table. I want to do this. I want to play this other thing. I want to do this third thing.
I'm holding things in, Ryan. Get to it.
I know. Yeah, let's... me and Will showed up at a game night. I've been practicing a lot on TTS with Brett. He's a great practice partner. Will shows up, and I don't know what Will's going to bring. I messaged Will. I'm like, is there anything you want to practice against? He's like, no. And I'm kind of hoping he'll bring Anakin, because this is just after Brett
this
beat
was on
my
Black
ass
Friday.
With his Anakin. So I was like, let's get a game in. And, Will, what did you bring of the new flavors of Legion Kool-Aid?
So, without knowing that Ryan had been running a terror campaign with double armor, I decided to bring a commander tank.
Yes!
Commander tank. So, I brought Aayla Secura in a T-170 whatever thing. This
would have been fine had it been against the T-41 from before the update. You would have been okay.
Sure. Yeah. How did you not know I was bringing... Our group chat was kind of filled with me playing this list.
Yes, but I tried to disregard it.
Even though no one was talking back to me, I'll still type.
It's just shouting into the void.
You kept posting this list and some pictures, and it's like, I'm playing this thing against Brett. And we're like, cool, bro. Cool.
Well, I did.
Oh,
I had two lists.
We love you so.
I had two lists, and I messaged Brett and said, hey, which of these should I play? And he's like, well, he has double armor. And I was like, well, I'll bring the armor then.
I'd forgotten your... And yeah, because Brett later did say, I told you.
Yeah. Because my whole list was... Brett did the same thing to Ryan. We both had these double ion lists ready, but then we knew Ryan played double vehicle, and it's like, well, that seems like we'd be... Ryan would be on this podcast saying that I list tailored if I brought double ion bark.
No, I would only say it if... No, look, double ion bark is... I'm not going to hate on you for that. That's...
Only if I'd beat you. It was going to be two ion HQ barks with Anakin Padme.
Yeah, I think that's solid. I won't be mad.
I think that is solid. I hate it, but I think it's actually really solid. I hate this movie.
It's on the queue. But
because even if armor or droids don't show up, it's still a solid. It's still a really good gun.
Yeah,
it's still red, five black, two white. Well,
and I'm not going to your house now. No, it's really good unless your dice just don't hit.
There's places right now. I'm tempted to take the rebel ion guy, the rebel trooper.
But so the bark is my only ion weapon.
But yeah, for clones. Ahead. Yes, that's true. That's also true.
So I don't have a person. I guess I have droid poppers.
You got droid poppers.
Which I'll only bring when Ben's coming to my house. This is why I invited you to play my Rebels.
All jokes aside, I don't hate the ion gun on the snowtroopers because you can afford to refresh and move and shoot. Like you can do that. That's a thing.
Well, that's
the
same with the
and it's range three
with
now.
The speeder since you get that free speeder move. Speeders kind of have a free action that you don't care about.
So the only mark against the ion bark is that you don't get an aim token, where the other loadouts get an aim, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you get better dice, so I don't know. I'll let you know when I try that.
So you have Ayla Secura.
I have Ayla Secura.
What was on Ayla?
It was the anti-armor missiles. Armor's going to be around.
Armor's going to be around.
Yeah, no, armor's going to be everywhere.
I told this to a listener, but every list should probably have an answer to an armor vehicle and or a lightsaber wielder.
Yep.
Because they're going to be bouncing around.
Luckily for me, the T-47 is both.
God.
Yes, it is.
So yeah, the tank just had Ayla and the impact rockets. Then we had R2 and Padme, then some core troopers, I think two phase twos, two phase ones, and a full ARC team. If that sounds familiar, it's basically my stamp. I put this in a list, and then I decide what goes in the operative and commander slot.
Right. I did like your list.
Because Padme can feel the dodges.
I didn't quite know what to do because I hadn't played up against a field commander, and I don't think it's a stretch to say I don't think Will knew what to do because he hadn't played a field commander.
Right.
Well, you only had four command cards in, right?
No, I played some of R2's cards.
Yeah, you
had
R2, Padme.
Oh, R2. Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
And Padme.
Yeah, that's what I was getting ready to ask. Like, what was your command hand? Did you just take all the hero cards? Or
no, it was all of Padme's cards, R2's 1 and 3, and then push.
Okay.
So I had one card that the tank commander could use. But
one standby.
So but I wanted the inspiring,
right,
and all that.
So we set up the table, and we get to turn zero. And was turn zero as rough for you as it was for me?
Slightly. Our table was kind of weird.
This is a family podcast.
Yeah, our table was kind of weird.
We played on rollout, and the deployments for rollout are always a little weird for troopers because you're like, I guess I'm just in the bump.
Honestly, I tend to put troopers in the bump and then roll the tank out beside them.
Yep.
That's what I did.
I mean,
so we played rollout, we played intercept transmissions, and the way that rollout and intercept is kind of weird because like you can put guys further back and they can still, you know, double move to get to the intercept tower if you want them to be kind of safe. And then we ended with limb viz, which is where I think the game went sideways for Will. Because Will, where did your tank go?
I mean, basically next to the nub and a little forward, but it was like range two away from.
Deploy it forward.
Your stuff had to move to get to range two, but I wanted to be able to shoot them when they moved towards me. Basically, I didn't want Ryan to be able to stand by castle at range two.
Yeah, I get that.
It feels weird when someone standbys castles, doesn't it, clone player?
It's the only time you other people can do it.
So I split my armor. I put my X-34, I want to say, actually started in the extended deployment zone, and the T-47 went outside of range one on the shorter edge. So they both kind of started almost parallel to each other, but on very, very different flanks. And when the game started, because I have some scout, because I have speeders with compulsory moves who are relatively fast, I got to range two of Will's commander, but nothing else. So I kind of had a turn of relative safety where I could squeeze not the best shots in the world because I was having to move in position to get to them. But my tanks got pretty good shots.
Yeah.
I think I got... Did I get Chewie to shoot round one or was he round two?
I think that was round two, but your land speeder rolled up and did about six crits.
Why? Yeah, it was it rolled up, and I've got the crit, you know, the impact two weapon on it.
I don't know the land speeder's that good, guys.
Land speeder seems pretty
good. But yeah, I rolled a bunch of natty crits in that roll, and it was pretty disgusting.
You rolled four natty crits and had impact two, yes.
The T-47 got into the side arc on the first attack run.
So it had impact four. Yep.
And like your tank saves were not great.
They were like red dice.
You had a couple good rolls. Yeah. You had good dodge tokens that you could fuel them up with exemplar. So and outmaneuver.
I had two dodges for it per turn, but those were not enough.
Han snuck in riding in the land speeder for just the first turn into another piece of heavy cover that hid him from some clone troopers, but he managed to scoot his way into the tank's side arc. And Han in the tank side arc is a scary situation, except I totally forgot about outmaneuver.
Right.
And so Han gets in there and I'm like, yeah, ping, ping. And he's just like, oh, I'll just spend these two dodge tokens here.
Yeah, you rolled like, crit surge.
I'm sad now.
Crit. Or maybe it was hit crit and you had impact one from the side. Whatever it was, you had two crits and I dodged them both with Padme's dodges.
Yeah.
And you were like, oh.
That was very sad.
Oh, right.
So what I'm hearing here is exactly what Tim was complaining about. Well, really, these games are decided by hot dice.
Yes, that's it. That's all it is.
Hot dice it, everything's fine. I mean,
all it is.
I don't think this game, Will can tell me I'm wrong. I don't feel like this game came down to hot dice. I feel like it came down to Limviz and Rollout both worked very, very well for me. Because the tank can do some damage, it can do some stuff.
Not usually.
The rest of your army really wasn't shooting the first turn.
No, I tried to move my army up behind the tank to use it as cover, and then it was gone turn two, and so the rest of my army was standing there for your air.
Yeah, I think I got the tank at the first activation of turn three, but yeah. It was pretty gross, and then the land speeder just flanked all over the place.
So the problem for me was that you had basically four big threats that I had to pick, and I didn't have enough answers for them. Because that first time the tank shot, I could either shoot your land speeder with an aim or pivot and shoot your air speeder, which like has one less cover. Right. But it was, and so I tried the land speeder, only did like two wounds, and then R2 fixed it for one action, and it was just like, ah, great. Loving this. I just didn't have a lot of answers for all the things coming at me at once. Although I did kill Han, which felt nice.
That's always the important
part. Padme nice. Popped
that's
Han.
What mounts. That's what matters the most.
He took a bunch of clone troopers with him before he went.
You took three clones, so I think. Four clones.
Han was shot to death by his mother-in-law. Seems fitting in this holiday spirit.
Yes. She was visiting.
If you want to see pictures of this terrible, terrible debacle, check out the Instagram, where I'm sure Will will post photos of his loss. I'm sure you will.
I'll post photos too
of that great work that Will did for me. My Maul and my droids look fantastic. He handed them to me in the dark of night last night, so I looked out this morning.
He's like, I got something for you in this box.
Yeah, yep.
Don't open
it. With my car. Looked left and right to make sure the cops weren't watching. So
don't open it till you get home.
They actually look really nice. And then I'm going to get to start painting again. Like, as soon as we wrap up this podcast, I'm going to go clean my house, and then I'm going to paint this afternoon.
My livelihood.
I can finally make that money back.
I may never financially recover from this.
I'm trying to clean my house so I can paint.
So, yeah, exactly. So check out the Instagram, STABcast. We're posting all the photos of all the things we like to do.
I just paint in a dirty house.
We know.
We know.
Be sure to check out Facebook and Twitter where we are, I guess. Give us a rating on iTunes and the Spoofy. We are available where podcasts are streamed, whatever you're listening on. I look at the analytics and see that it's mostly Apple Podcasts, so cool. Have a nice listen to our dulcet tones.
Although I will say our analytics, I think, pull Apple differently than the rest of the stuff does.
Yeah.
I think Apple RSS is a little different. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. So I think that's how they're able to say it came from Apple, where the other feeds I don't think are able
I'm
to
a Spotify man myself.
I am too.
I mean.
Despite being also an Apple man.
And if we're in your Spotify year recap for your best podcast. Send us a screen cap. We'd love it.
I would love to shower you with praise if you're one of our 0.5.
Sure. We were the number one, we were the number one podcast that I listened to.
Oh, we weren't mine.
Because I always listen back.
We weren't mine. I listened to my cult podcast on Spotify. So
the other ones were top podcasts were Legion podcasts.
Look at you go. I thought you'd be better by now listening to them.
Oh, I had one. I had one random doctor's podcast, and the rest were all Legion podcasts.
Mine were mostly about history and crime, and a little bit of Legion.
Well, Legion is a crime when clones play. So,
yep, I had to practice my war crime knowledge.
It feels weird to defend a multinational conglomerate organization, but I still like my Google cast. So,
stick it up for the little man, Google.
Yes. No one's even heard of that. Google? Is that it?
Google.
It's a Mongolian podcasting service.
But speaking of services, you can find us on the Discord service. All of us are on there. I fix my name, so I now am at STABcast something. I think I'm called the Tennessee Second Wheel right now. but you know,
appropriate.
It's the Tennessee Two Wheels.
Excuse me. And then also on those wonderful streaming services, like Will said.
Yes.
If you want to reach out to us, which you guys have been doing more and more lately, you can obviously find us in any of those aforementioned places. But you can also send us an email at swstabcast@gmail.com. We got a lovely email from Eric earlier in the week. We miss you, buddy.
Reaching out really sending us terrible lists that I'm not going to play? Because I don't know if that's really reaching out more than just mocking me.
That's what we're getting a lot of lately. And we're thinking about, I'm thinking about, we need to come up with like a litmus test to see who gets to send us lists that we're going to play. And if you send us a list, we get to send lists back that you have to play.
That's true.
I'm looking at you people who are sending me range 2 only lists. You know who you are.
Do it.
So do you want to make the devil's bargain? Will you send me Hellfire and I'll send you Hellfire back?
But you guys can also support the show, which you guys have done a ton of, and we really do appreciate it with the new t-shirts. You can find that at teespring.com/store/stabcast. I just got my Stabcast hoodie in, and for like a print on demand like hoodie, it is remarkably soft.
I've heard good things. For everyone that's been getting shirts, A, thank you. B, I've heard good things.
But we did get another message in from my man Jay Muth. How the hell do you play Payload? He's a little background. Jay is a Triple Bikes only player.
My man.
And he's a little stuck on what fourth objective card to play. And so me and him got to talking about Payload, and he wanted to know like how to make Payload like viable, because he's not been able to make it work.
So here's my thought on this. Is you take a bid that's high enough that you just don't include Payload in your bid, period. I would never have to play it.
Well, for that list, hold on. I really enjoy Payload. I love Payload. With the right list. I actually really like Payload. With the right list. So this is not the right list for Payload.
When I blow up the other player's units. Yeah. Like, I've never actually won Payload by playing the objective.
Right.
I have.
I would argue this is not the right list for Payload, respectively. I just don't. Yes. That's not what I aim to play with Triple Bikes. I completely agree with you, Tim.
I don't think this is the list for Payload. So you definitely. Yeah. But if for some reason the 800 point dilemma, the red player's dilemma, Jay gets stuck with Payload, how does he do it with his list?
I think you're going to use, and we talked about this a little before, but I mean, the bikes are hit and run units, right? And now with the speeder fix weakness, but with the speeder fix, they can now. Hit and run supposedly more effectively. I guess people weren't doing it effectively before, whatever. But now you can do it more effectively, quote unquote. And so I think you're really just helping them push people off of the Payload point, I suppose. Or maybe you split your bikes and run one on defense and run two on offense. I don't know. That's the only thing I would think of. I
would never split the bikes.
I normally wouldn't either. I wouldn't either, but I'm trying to think of how do you deal with this situation.
I like the idea of blowing up anything that's within range one of the Payload. I do.
Just don't play Payload with that list and you'll be fine. That's it. That's the best strategy. That's it. Just don't do it. Don't do it. But I agree with Ryan a little bit. Like helping force them off the point. Yeah, maybe. Just trying to hope they don't commit enough forces, maybe. I don't know.
The news.
Listen, we have good news. Well, sort of good news.
News. Kinda. There's good and bad news. Although Ryan already did the bad news, so here we are. Luke Eddy. Yeah, the guy.
Yes.
He's a guy. He's a guy. We like Luke.
He's a guy that Tim sort of knows exists. Oh my God.
Tim now knows who he is.
He bumped into him at a dinner cocktail. He's like, here's my keys. Go grab my car.
All right, y'all people. He's officially...
Yes, Tim, tell us what he does now besides park your car at LVO.
Official lead developer at AMG. Whatever.
It is good to hear because there's a lot of concern in the community that we may be losing some of that upper management that had that vision and design.
Yes.
And it's a good thing. I'm glad for him.
It's a great thing.
Hearing that works out for him. Eased a lot of my anxiety because, again, to lose both creators would be, I think, catastrophic. But to keep one in there, I'm at least happy. I'll take the one. Really like two, but I'll take the one. I'll take what I can get. And Luke's a great guy, so I think he'll do wonderful at that. So now I can finally shift from nervous to excited to see where it's going to go. At least I can do that comfortably.
Yes.
Yeah. My favorite Luke Eddy memory was Gen Con year one. I was attempting to push my second or third opponent's commander off the table with Luke Skywalker back when you were allowed to do that. And my opponent called him over to see if that was legal. And he just looks me dead in the eyes and says, "It's legal. For now," and just walks away.
You made it about how you have impacted the game. Yes.
No, I know for sure I was not the only person doing that, but it was.
That was a favorite of yours, Discord, who did that to all sorts of people. He came on the Discord after he officially shared the announcement of taking over to AMG and or Legion over at AMG, and so it was kind of good. And he answered a lot of smaller questions, not obviously some of the more tricky questions, like the more political questions, but just some very fun ones, and was kind of communicating with us, which was nice to have again. So it was good after a lot of long period of darkness to have some sunlight.
Nice, but
to go back in the darkness.
Back to the darkness,
bad news, everybody.
LVO, my baby, the thing I've been looking forward to literally since last LVO. Unsurprisingly, was canceled. It's very sad.
You know, when I called the Flamingo to cancel my hotel, the clerk was very, very nice and very peppy. She's like, "Oh, so what are you coming out for?" I was like, "A conference." I guess we'll cancel your family room because, you did have the two queens and the bunk beds. My family room.
Absolutely.
It's a shame my family and I cannot come out to my conference.
I will miss my family so much.
But no, really, I wanted to go to, we talked about just keeping our hotel room just going to Vegas.
I thought about it.
It's sad. And of course, right behind that, Adepticon, not happening either.
Yeah, that's not
true. Yeah, I mean,
it's a mid-March piece. You're just not sure enough. The vaccine won't be there.
Yeah.
Monday or Tuesday, me and Will were messaging, and it was right after LVO would get canceled, and so we're like, has anyone even looked at Adepticon? Because normally, like, tickets go on sale in November, and registration for events is usually about this time. And none of us had ever looked at it. So Will looks it up, and Adepticon's like last official social media post was about like Black Lives Matter over the summer. And so we're like, yeah, that's probably not happening. And then earlier this week, then they had also officially canceled the events, which is rightly so. Like, if you've had no press about it, no big events lined up, because the difference, in my opinion, of like LVO and Adepticon is LVO is like it's in Vegas. If nothing else, you can go do Vegas-y things. But Adepticon is there's always these big marquee, huge events.
Like what else are you going to do? You're going to go to Chicago?
It was the Hoth Open.
You're going to have breakfast, Tim. You're going to have breakfast and have a lovely cup of coffee.
You're going to go to Chicago, eat some like bread and cheese casserole because that's not pizza. But, that's fine.
God. Tim's New York sensibility is wrong. Deep dish is wrong. Okay. Chicago, number one in my heart.
Yeah,
I don't like my pizza on a piece of tissue paper.
it's 3-1 here, Tim. Sorry.
At least it's not a California.
That's three wrong people to one right one.
That's true. No, we can all agree with that. We can all agree with that.
It's not a California cracker. Other news. Adepticon is dead for the year. So is LVO. Yep. Next year, 2022.
Next year.
Might be a Gen Con. Yeah. We'll see.
I could see
I'm holding out hope for Gen Con.
Yeah, I can see
I'm
it.
Holding out.
I could see it.
It'll be interesting, like, to go to a convention where we're going to have to, like, send them our vaccination records. Yeah. Like, are we going to have to walk around Gen Con with our papers out where they can just stop us? Papers, please.
Hopefully.
Oh. And we're like, look,
is that a costume I can wear?
Carriers.
Yeah, Tim, get on that staff if you can volunteer.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, it is.
In other news, we did get news, and it was whispered to us much like this. He spoke to us like this about the news, Ryan.
So, yeah,
your friends,
our good friend Krabs, or my good friend, I don't know, my good friend Krabs,
who
spotted on the Asmodee's French distribution website, where all the good leaks tend to come from these days, that the Rebels next release is going to be an AA5 speeder Winnebago pickup truck of doom.
It is so a Winnebago. Like, I didn't even know this it really existed. I mean, it's a flat-out Winnebago.
It's basically saying, did you think the technical was really weird? Look at this. We're just going to throw all the Rebels in a farm truck and just drive it down the interstate. That's it.
But it's not a farm truck, because this is clearly where the closed transport's coming from.
Yeah, this is going to be our first closed transport. Theoretically, I think it's pretty safe to say that the Imperials will get a very similar release. Like, the Rebels and Imperials have had pretty much paired releases, with the exception of, I want to say, the Chewy Palp Guards Wookiees releases were a little mismatched. But everything else has been like, you get a heavy, they get a heavy. You get a support, they get a support. So I think it's safe to say that we'll see some kind of closed transport.
Could get that hover box that transports stormtroopers in the Mandalorian.
Yeah, that's what I'm actually looking for. The one where you have the troopers on the outside of the transport.
Well, it's also in Rebels.
The thing on the inside.
But at that point, it's not a closed transport then. Yeah.
They had a room in the back that they could sit in.
The troopers on the outside are part of the guns for that unit.
Probably. Yeah.
Right. So here's the interesting thing is, this is at least the way that I play Rebels and the way that I play Legion. This is not the thing I was looking for. This kind of caught me by surprise. Not going to lie. You know, we've got Lando coming, and then from Lando to a closed transport. Now, maybe if it's cheap enough, maybe as like a Wookiee or a fleet delivery system. But if it's going to be another 100-ish points heavy, is a closed transport worth that much of your army as a Rebel player?
If it's 100 points and it wheels R2-D2 to the place where he gets his thing, protects him while he's getting the secret mission, and you put him back in the thing and drive away?
Yeah.
I mean, that's yeah, honestly.
No, thank you.
No.
Boba Fett has to go grab that box and live.
No, thank you.
Now, Brett, I'm going to need this to be painted like the A-Team van and one like Spaceballs Winnebago.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, I mean, Star the Bagel thing 5 I'm excited for... I'm more excited for the Star Tours ship is what people are going to put down. Mm-hmm. And I know we already have 3D prints of those.
Yeah.
Because there's that table at LVO that was also like a Star Tours spaceport, which is really cool.
I'm going to paint mine from Archer. Make it Vanagon 2.
Insert a good Lord van of the Rings joke. Van.
Oh, there's so many painted vans here. It's going
to
be
amazing. There's so many great ways that people are going to come up with paint this. it's going to be interesting. We don't know anything other than the product name, so we can speculate all day about like what kind of armaments it will have, what kind of weapons or hull profile. But yeah, is this going to be the first Rebel red armor save that we're going to see?
No, thank you. Go away. Probably. No, thank you. You don't deserve it.
As long as it does nothing.
I don't like it.
You don't deserve it.
Wow. That hurts. That hurts right here, Tim. Hurts right
that's
here.
Fine.
He's pointing at his trophy rack, isn't he?
All of that is well into the future. All of this is well into the future. So let's talk about the now. And that's the winter holidays coming up. So a lot of people are going to be joining us for Legion, or they're going to be finding some time to get into the hobby to really try it. So listen, we're going to talk about paint today. I'm getting back in time to paint, so that's always kind of nice. So I'm going to try to work it out there.
I'm getting there.
If you like to play with the gray models, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Yep. You're more than welcome. Nothing we wrong want with that. To see you playing.
It's okay Please to be play. Named Landon.
Is it?
Hey, yeah. He's got since CIS came out, he's gotten a lot better.
I know.
His droids are painted.
He's gotten like six droids painted.
Yeah, he does have six droids painted.
There's primer on them, so hey, look at that.
And I say this as a man who has paid Will to paint my entire CIS army.
I have.
And in fact, at this point, I probably won't paint the CIS. I'll paint everything else, and I'll continue to pay Will, in part because the colors all look the same, like he's got the eye for the detail, and the theming matches.
I got the hooks in.
Right.
But I just pay Will to paint me.
He's got me. He's just in my wallet all the time, but... If you want to try to paint a model, this is a perfect game to do it. Because when it hits the table with a little bit of paint on it, it looks so great up to against your terrain. Even if your terrain is Amazon boxes and pieces of styrofoam you peeled out of whatever else you got for Christmas, that's also cool. But you know, we've talked about terrain building, so let's talk about painting this week. So start with Will Bob Rosheim.
Well, hello, and thank you for joining me this week on the Joy of Painting. Really, what we want to do is eliminate the gray plastic armies, like Ben was saying. And the first step is just slinging that paint on those minis. No regrets.
Just beat the devil out of it.
Beat the devil out of them. Take a big 4-inch paint and flat brush and just whack them and be like, my tie-dye rebels are done. And
Part of it is there's so much detail on a model, people start freaking out like, I can't paint the faces. Then don't paint the faces.
That's okay.
Then don't paint the faces. I don't paint the faces.
That's what I do. Be like Ryan. My veer, don't give a shit. This is the one time I'm going to say be like Ryan.
My veer still has a bronze face like his armor because I was just like, you know what? He's going to be Robo Veers. That's it. Because he was one of the first models
real
ever.
Real Cobra Commander.
Yeah, one of the first models I ever painted was veers because his first expansion. So,
Every time I try to paint eyeballs, one of them ends up like a domino cut. Yes. Like it's just like a vertical eye. I understand. And I don't know why.
They all have like a problem. The right one would be fine.
Left one cat eye.
So, I mean, I started painting off with, like, I played Warhammer in high school because I got my first job and went, what's money? And threw it all into Warhammer. But I showed up with these
mistakes, Will.
With these terrible, terrible painted Warhammer minis. And I still showed up and they were like, ah, cool, man. Those look great. But, like, the fact that there was effort put in was enough for all sorts of game groups. No one's going to turn you away for gray models, but they always appreciate a painted game. Like, you know, we talk about Ryan and Brett's monstrosities, and they play each other. It's just a unicorn rainbow barfed all over a table.
Whoa.
But it looks better. It looks better than if it was, you know, Landon playing another starter set person, and it was just gray everywhere.
Well, and also, it should be noted, too, even for these bigger events, that really it's only like LVO and Adepticon that might require a painting. It doesn't say you have to be good at it. It's just three colors. Like,
three colors.
You can, you just need you a can put colors. Primer, a wash, and like a red laser beam or something, like a red dot on the end of your rifle. You've done it. Congratulations. You've hit three colors.
Well, and that's it. No local play night or tournament should have a painting requirement.
Yeah. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, no one's going to care. It's fine.
Yeah. So the first real minis game I took that was unpainted was Imperial Assault. And I played that at Adepticon my very first time. And the judges were just singing the praises of me and another guy because we were the only ones who had painted models there. And they weren't the greatest painted models in the world.
Right.
But they add such a splash of color to your table. It'll bring people out. If you're playing in your local game store, gray models don't necessarily do it. But you put painted models on there, people want to see them. People want to look at them. They want to talk to you about them. And that's how you grow your scene.
It's funny you say that because actually I remember your painted IA models. And I was like, you can paint minis? That's a thing you can do? That was my life back then because all I played was X-Wing and they were pre-painted for me. Like a child in kindergarten getting the pre-sealed food, and, you know, it's fine.
And I'll be honest, I think probably two of my best models may still be my IA models.
That's right.
Yeah.
My Harrison Dula, it just snaps there. It's just so fantastic.
But just paint something. And heck, paint some extra units. Like if you're a new player and you happen to be listening to this podcast, first off, how'd you find us? I'm sorry. Secondly, take your HH-12. Paint that. You're never going to use it, so just paint that and
or if you learn how to paint that. And the other, you haven't found someone to pawn the other side off to, just like start with those rebels and be like, what do colors do?
Paint Pathfinders.
I mean, paint the Rebel Ion guy, because you're never going to use them. Yeah. Right. So
you're never going
to. There's so many people you just never use. Just paint him and learn how to paint on those. And in fact, those are my test models.
Go to the dollar store and grab a bag of $2 Army Men that you get like a dozen of them. Prime those up and start painting there. It's easier if you're just, or if you're, if you feel underconfident, you don't want to try to paint something with that much detail. Just start there, use a wash, and you will see how like wash covers a multitude of sins and makes you go from like a zero to hero. Like,
liquid talent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's quick talent. It really is.
Oh, yeah.
It's why people love that contrast paint. It's just like, oh, look. It's like,
we'll get there.
We'll get there. Yeah. And part of it too is when you're learning things, make sure, I did this mistake in my first few models, make sure you prime. You have to prime. You have to prime, kids. You might think, priming, oh, this is an extra important step I don't want to bother with. You have to prime. Be aware, this is some really basic level stuff, but you just want to make sure you know. Don't prime in super cold weather, because that can make your paint kind of glunk up and be nasty, especially your primer, because what's going to happen is if you prime like that and then it gets nasty, that means no matter how good you paint with your final paint job, it's still going to be screwed up because your primer screwed up.
Yeah, painting in the cold weather or very humid weather can cause it to basically dry before it hits the model, so it ends up in these like kind of crunchy flakes instead of a smooth paint.
It's not a good time.
But you know, you don't have to go out and buy a paint box for these kind of things. In fact, my paint box has been an Amazon box I've had for years now, and I just ripped off the sides of it to make a 3-wall space.
Yes.
And then I just glue the bases to the little small pieces of cardboard from my last Amazon box. I just put them on the little thing. I mean, I spray paint on top of my air conditioning unit because it's blowing stuff out anyway. So.
That's right.
Right.
People always recommend the stick, which is just like a piece of wood you find. Then you just poster tack models onto it and use it to hold them while you spray paint them.
Yep.
But priming really is, in part because it'll cover up some of that griminess, or it hopefully looks like an even color base on it. Yeah. Sometimes it's difficult to do. Before you start that model, you go select the colors you want. And if you can't figure out what colors you need, go pick up one of these very nice, relatively inexpensive starter boxes of paint. I'm a Vallejo man myself, but for about $35, $40, $50, you can get a great set of Vallejo paints that have all you need for a Rebel army. Yeah. Or all the colors you need for the Imperial army. The FFG box is not a bad box if you want to start there.
They're actually really good deals. I got like a 96 set like army painter box when I got into started painting, and the FFG, like official Star Wars Legion paints, are also army painter. They work fantastic. You just got to thin them down a little and out of the bottle, and I like the dripper bottles better than the paint pots from Citadel. I just make a mess with those.
Yeah,
I much prefer the dripper bottles myself, but yeah.
I transferred all my Citadel paints into dripper bottles, which is a whole nother step, but
I started on the Citadel stuff, and I've just kept with them just to keep it consistent, but I have no strong feelings either way.
Yeah.
Although I do like contrast paints, which we'll get to in a second.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So I think the first thing that really took, and Will showed me this trick, when I first started painting, that took my, I started with washes, and washes make my army look a lot better.
Yes.
But once you can figure out, and it's relatively easy, a good dry brush technique, it will take the texture, especially on a lot of these Rebel models who have like, stormtroopers just have laminate armor and those like smooth surfaces, and like the hardest detail you have is like the knees where the undersuit goes.
Yeah.
But Rebels have belts and pouches and pockets and rank insignias and goggles on their forehead and a chin strap for their hat and all these little extra details. Learning just a really basic dry brush to make those, though, all those raged edges really, really pop and show to give depth to the model. Because that's the cool thing about painting a model over like a canvas or a 2D medium, is you do get that depth and all those little cool three-dimensional details, and let light play with them. Mm-hmm. But figuring out how to dry brush,
Yeah.
And dry brush is a thing that I'm not great at.
Same.
Because this is going to sound really crazy. I'm a slow painter, but I'm also incredibly impatient. So, like, I don't want to put a model down and come back to it 2 weeks from now.
Yes.
Like, Will is great. Like, I have these models I'm starting. This is in phase two of the process. This is phase three.
I have drawers where they sit, depending on where they are. Like,
I want to finish this unit today.
Dry brushing isn't slow.
Yeah.
Yeah, dry brushing isn't slow.
No, but that's what I'm saying. It isn't slow, but I don't want to wait for the previous paint to dry.
He doesn't want a third step.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, gotcha. I don't want that third step. So I fight that battle in myself, which is why I'll tend to paint two or three units at a time. So while one is drying, I can work on something else.
Oh, batch painting is pretty essential.
Yeah. I learned that real quick from, we're going to throw this way back to when I had 72 hours to paint my Gen Con top 16 Rune Wars army. There were 17 players. I had to crunch all those little spearmen out.
And if you're buying the core set for the first time, you're going to do a lot of batch painting.
Yes.
Because that's what Ryan and I did. We set up my house for a day or two and just took care of it.
Yep. That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. But so you get those basics down. Yeah, what's next? What's the next step?
Are we graduating from elementary to middle school painting?
We are going up to middle school. Hooray.
Oh boy, my acne. Which is where my hormones.
I was going to say, your acne's breaking out. You're starting to notice other painting jobs, thinking like, oh, those are attractive. You don't know what to do with these.
YouTube advice for how to do certain things.
Yeah. You don't know what to do with your new brushes. growing out. And just don't know what to do. Guide us. I personally, when I graduated, I went into contrast paints. That's where I dipped into a new level of I don't know if I certainly wouldn't say skill, but opportunity Ability. For skill. Yes, opportunity for skill that I probably don't always have. But going into contrast paints, like being able to just prime and contrast, for a while I thought that was it. And then I realized you had to do some more details after you got done contrasting.
If you want.
Yeah, if you want. But this the ability to do contrast, that is a great way to do. You talk about batch painting, like for stormtroopers and things like that. Mm-hmm. Oh, perfect. Absolutely perfect is contrast paints all day. If I buy a squad that's a more traditional kind of squad, like core unit, I'm just going to probably batch paint them with contrast and most likely be done with it. I might do some touch-up later.
That should be fine, honestly. Your rank and file stuff just kind of merges and, the herd just kind of all looks the same from far away.
Yeah, from 3 feet away, you're not going to notice the difference.
They don't need as much detail as your commanders.
And that's the thing that you have to decide as a painter and as a player.
Right.
People, are you going to be the player like Will, where you want people to pick up and look at your models and people are going to pull them really close to their grimy, nasty faces, breathe all over your models, but look at all the fine details and all the work you put in them? For me, my rule is I try to get my models to where they are 3 feet. They look great from 3 feet away and three beers in.
That's right. I will say, let me just throw in here about contrast paints. I did learn you don't traditionally, and it's different, but I learned this the hard way. You don't traditionally need to contrast and wash the same model or the same parts of a model. And sometimes if you're trying to get a certain effect, you might want to do it. But as a whole, don't contrast and wash. I learned that the hard way because I did both. And I was like, wow, this is just nothing but shadow. Like, there's one thing to have some shadows on a model. This Darkness. Whole unit is shadow.
The contrast paints are very good for introductory things and things like that. But they do teach you kind of how to paint incorrectly with normal paint, so it's it's being aware of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So contrast paints, I've actually had some success with. Like I said, with Rebels and all their details, you just can't kind of Rebels, slather it's awesome. It on.
Yeah,
but contrast paints are cool. But don't let your contrast paints be the end of what you do.
Yeah.
Ben is going to hate contrast paints. Ben will probably never buy a contrast paint because you do have to paint that stuff. And then I'm the type of guy that, when I start a squad, I'll just pick a color and I'll do everything of that color for the whole squad and then put it down, pick up another color, and hopefully the first model I started with is dry to where I can start the next color. You know, we've talked about batch painting. But with contrast paints, you've got to let that stuff sit for a while.
I mean, literally, because I'm working on a single unit, that's what I'm doing.
Right.
All these colors are the ones I'm working on first.
This stuff just takes longer.
When you do contrast, the stuff takes forever to dry because it does kind of have that oily wash built into it. And so usually when I'll prime, wait a couple hours, I'll do my contrast paint. And then that's when I put contrast paint on a model, I'm done with that model for the day. I'm not going to revisit it till at least, 12 hours later. I'm sure I don't have to wait that long, but I've burned myself by picking up a model too quickly.
Yeah. If you disturb the stuff, it's really hard to get it back to how it would have looked. Because if you move it out of where it's pooled up, then it will have a tide mark where it had dried and it's all kinds of ruined.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've not bought a contrast paint because that's the part that I fear.
You just have to, like he's saying, you just have to slather it on and go watch a couple of TV shows or something.
Or paint, start a different painting project, paint a different unit.
And now for something completely different.
So I've got to ask, and part of this is So for me, it's a vision issue. I paint with really bright light so I can see everything. Mm-hmm. And I know that most stores aren't that well lit. Most homes aren't that well lit. So the colors do change when I go from that brightness to that normal lighting situation.
Right.
What do you all do?
I've had this issue for a little while, but now that I have this gaming table, sometimes when I need a change of perspective, I will walk over and kind of set it on the table and kind of like Ryan said, step back a bit and get it under normal lighting and look at it in a gameplay setting. Like, just like, oh, look, there it is across the table from me. Okay, so it needs maybe a little brighter on this, I don't need to work on that as much. So maybe for you, Ben, just like set it on your dining table and kind of look at it without the bright ass light at it.
Yeah,
I do.
Yeah. But
The lighting in my living room is terrible.
Yes.
Yes.
And
yes,
so is. I actually, honest to God, have a painting headlamp.
Yep.
That works.
Where I want that bright light to paint, I can get in the cracks and crevices, make sure I got my paint where I need it. But then I can just click the headlamp off, put it on my kitchen table, and see what it looks like in less than idyllic lighting situations. But yeah, I just have a big My living room has like really a lack of outlets and overhead lighting. It's very strange.
The best thing I got was I have a little, it's for welding, soldering. And it's just like got a little glass, like magnifying glass in the front of it with a little built-in light and two little clamps on it. So that helps me hold things together if I'm trying to glue things in a weird angle or something. Those are great, super handy. But then also it's just a nice little lamp that I can adjust. Sometimes I don't use the magnifying glass. I just use the light from the magnifying glass. But it gives me options and it's pretty compact and easy to pack up and put away.
And I know, and I just said that I'm a person who hates the anticipation and the waiting, but you do have to thin the paint down a little bit.
Oh yeah.
When you use the thicker globs of paint, it'll retract.
Yeah.
Put it on there and then it'll draw backwards.
How do we make it out of elementary without saying thin your paints? What the hell is wrong with us?
It's ubiquitous.
Because it is ubiquitous. It is. Is it what every young painter does first? Oh, blah, blah, blah. And then because you get coverage, you do. But the thicker it is, it tends to retract a little bit or may crack on the edges or it may turn a little bit globby that you didn't see but the heaviness of the paint has caused it to just drip a little bit.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Melty base.
This is the refinement of that technique, and it's just a little bit. Now, you could get fancy and go with the Lamian medium, which I've never seen in a real store.
Nope.
I'm told it exists.
You don't need Lamian medium except for a few edge cases. Don't need medium. For Lamian medium, it's just for like when you want washes to be different. That's the only time. Water works just fine. You just basically, my rule of thumb is you put some paint out, you dip your brush in your water pot, and just stir that into it, and then you should be fine. Yeah. Something that can also help with thinning paints is the wet palette.
What?
The wet palette, which is basically a sponge, and then you put a sheet of parchment paper over that, and you can make this out of a house sponge, or you can buy one like I did for $20, or more expensive ones that exist where they're made of metal and they're all fancy. Do whatever you want with that. Fancy. But essentially what this can do is also it needs to be sealable, like you put it in a Tupperware if you're making a homemade one. And what that does is you can put paint on that parchment paper and the water from the sponge keeps the surface moist enough that your paints don't dry out as quickly like in a plastic palette. And you can seal it and come back to that paint later if something happens and you need to stop or if you got too much on the palette. It doesn't just dry out and you peel it off of your plastic palette and go, well, there went that much paint. So it's helped me a lot with not burning through paint as quickly that I paint all the time.
Cool. With all the lights that I put on it, and my living room tends to get a little bit warm when I'm doing this anyway, my paints will dry a little bit fast, so either I have to add more paint to it or make sure I move a little bit faster through that. Yeah. It will start to dry pretty quick.
Now, if you're having issues with that, you could buy a product that will slow the drying time of your paint, so you could mix a couple drops in.
But that is one of the things. It's one of the things I still need to invest in is a wet palette. I need to. At some point, I'll take the jump. I need to do it. I've heard nothing but good things.
The pre-made one I have has lasted a couple of years. I've only had to buy one replacement sponge for it. It's done great. Nice.
There you go. So you get your wet palette. What's the next thing you do? What's the next step?
So you graduate up to the next step. You're getting some good successes here. You've moved on to the high school level of painting.
You're starting to hit your stride a little bit.
And this can be in whatever time frame you need, we're not saying this should be monthly or yearly. Yeah, exactly. It's whatever, whenever you feel like you're getting to a point that you want to step up. Step up.
Be your own person, like in high school.
Right.
Here's the thing. Not all black needs to be black.
Oh.
I know that, you know, Death Troopers are all in black, and all the Vaders are all in black, and Maul's dressed in black. But the problem is, when you take black, glossy blacks, you know, soft black, whatever it may be, it is just black. Yeah. And you lose so much of the detail, because black absorbs a whole bunch of light. Yep. That's what it does.
It do.
And so sometimes a dark gray is actually better.
Yes.
Because it allows that contrast between the things that need to be black and those things that don't need to be.
Yes.
My Vader, his chest plate is not all black. Like, it is mostly a darkish, stormy, cloudy gray.
Yep.
With lines of black in it.
So that's,
you can highlight in dark gray.
Something I use for black is the black contrast paint.
I knew you were going to say, if you didn't say it, I was going to.
And because I don't just, you know, put it on and stop, but I look at it where it's, where it puts the darkness and the highlights, and I use that as kind of a guide, and then go over it with some lighter colors, and then put darker black in the recesses, and like, that's what I did with Ben's Maul.
Yeah,
and it looks fantastic.
It's really solid, and you can always go over it with a darker wash or something like that if you want to get that darker effect that we were talking about before. That sometimes happens by accident. If you want that, you can do it. But I like the
without a strong light source on a normal gaming table, it's just going to be, oh, there's the black blob.
Yep. Yes.
See that cloud?
He's right. Moving this way.
Yeah. So something else I'll do is that I'll highlight it up to where it's almost like a gray model, and then do, like you said, with another, I'll hit it with Nuln Oil to darken it all down a little bit.
I've Nuln Oiled it before to give it a little bit darker shade.
Yep. It just helps me be able to highlight to where I like it. And then it's like, okay, because otherwise I couldn't be able to see the transitions well enough and things like that. Yeah, so it's just helpful.
And this is a good place to start experimenting with gloss and flat and satin finishes. Yes. Like, you know, these, you can have a clear finish that goes over something that kind of pops that out. Right. Stormtroopers look great in white, but when you get that glossy white on them, I once bought a pearlescent white that I loved until I could never find it again. that I love for the Stormtroopers. Like, it was just shiny.
Oh, yeah, Reaver paint.
The side story, my first ever gloss that I bought, I don't know what it was. It was just from, like, Hobby Lobby or something. I put it on my unit, and it stripped the paint. Like, it made it really glossy. It made it glossy. But then when I went to move the model after it dried, it just chipped off and came off. And I went, what? And it went back down to primer level. I was like, oh, okay.
Now, was this an enamel paint?
I don't know what it was. Yeah. It was an accident.
Because don't mix your acrylics and enamels and things like that. That's probably very important. What
it was. Yeah. It wasn't labeled. But, you know, it was like
the medium used to hold the paint might actually dissolve your other paints, like Ben or Tim is talking about. So be careful with that.
That's right. Yeah. It's all part of the fun.
And part of it is, if you ever started painting model cars as a kid, you were probably using enamel.
Yep. Testers like, that's and things they, like that are all
testers
enamels.
Testers, enamel. Yeah, exactly. Tamiya
paints are great, but I just don't want to use them because it'll fumigate my home.
Yes.
I want to be so high while painting. No. The acrylic, I also think, is a little bit smoother. Like, I think it applies better. It doesn't, it's more forgiving, I guess, would be the better phrase.
It's smoother, but theoretically less tough, but. Yes, we also would advocate using varnishes to seal your models, paint jobs in, so they do not chip off slowly over time.
Yeah, at the end, when you're done, I absolutely recommend sealing that bad boy up in a clear coat. But absolutely. And you can get a glossy clear coat, you can get a satin one flat, you can do whatever, but I recommend it just so that when you don't drop a model, I can tell where I've not sealed models. I'm like, oh, look, I'm going to have to repaint that. And of course, I never get to it on time.
It just bothers you a little bit every time.
Yeah, it bothers me every time.
Something that very much upped my game was starting to use an airbrush.
Yes.
Which I know a lot of people are, there's an anti-airbrush crowd out there, to which I say, okay, cool. Airbrushes are pretty awesome.
Yeah.
So let me ask, how are you using your airbrush? Because I bought one for myself as a birthday gift a year and a half ago, before I started my graduate program and realized I'm not going to have time for anything. And I've used it to do base coating. I've used it to do my primer. Yeah. But I've not had success because that model is so tiny and I'm not making t-shirts at the beach. How do I use an airbrush on a model?
So,
yeah, I got one and I'm the least qualified person to have one.
I started out the same way, just like I'd use it to prime indoors so I don't have to worry about the weather outside. Having a nice hood like Ben and I have to kind of keep the paint gas contained is very good because otherwise your house will start turning gray.
Yeah, the particles will go up in the air with an airbrush. Yes. So you have to be very careful.
If you have a garage, that's a great place for it.
Yeah.
homeowner over there.
With great garage way, comes great responsibility, all right?
That's yes, true. Look at this guy. He mows his lawn.
That's not true. I pay fair. Someone to do that.
He pays people to mow. What I've started doing now is just I will prime and then I'll find out what my first color is going to be. And I've started buying Vallejo's airbrush mixes just because I could thin it, but I'm never going to get the same. I'm not going to write down my ratios well enough and keep all track of that.
Right.
So I'll just figure out what color I want and go buy the Vallejo Game Air that'll match the Vallejo color that I had before and spray it through the airbrush and do like base coating. I'm still not to the level of doing detail work with it because if you're trying to paint like individual details on minis, there are different airbrushes you need for that, like a Sotar 2020 where the needle is hard to see. Things like that.
I mean, so listeners, I tell you that I pay Will to put together my CAS models. And so I know he just airbrushes all that brown for all the B1s, yes, and I'm perfectly fine with that, because he also went through the difficulty of putting the thing together.
I also washed them afterwards and then painted details and things like that.
And you do all the little details. Oh, they look fantastic. But I know he spends like 4 minutes after assembly, like, and does the entire arm at once.
Yes.
I mean,
it's let me do a lot of that batch work really quickly, where instead of taking each one and, you know, doing two coats of whatever brown color, so that I don't do it too thickly. Airbrushes are very good at applying coats smoothly.
Yeah.
They're great for vehicles if you're trying to get those done. Painting a vehicle with just a brush is difficult.
Piggybacking off
a wide swatch.
Yeah. Piggybacking off of what you said about for batch painting, going back to batch painting. The big thing is then, and I learned this, I did this early on and now I do it more overtly. I did it very covertly for my first few things I painted, which was great for me, not so great for opponents. And so I apologize for that. But it's making differences for your squads, making sure you add differences in those batches. So like squad A looks different than squad B. Clones and storms, it's a little bit easier if you're doing traditional white and whatever other color you want to use to differentiate, because you can say like, okay, these, you know, red shoulder pauldrons, there you go. Those are those guys. My guys, I painted all like this cool bronze color, which I still love that color, but I painted their backpacks different, like their little comms unit or whatever's in their back. And like one's gray, one's red. Great. The problem is your opponent can't normally see that. So they're all facing me. And so I can tell which is which, but my opponent can't always tell. So now I'm a little bit more overt with my color differences just to help it out.
If you don't want to break the canon with you want to paint everything like as you saw it in the movie.
Right.
The best way to go about doing that is the base ring.
Yeah.
Yes.
After you're done basing your model, put a ring. Just paint the outer edge of your ring.
Yes.
You know, all of your blue squad guys the same color. And,
yes.
And I went full Power Rangers with most of my units, but with the Rebels, I don't think it looks as outlandish if you've got just a bunch of like blue accessories on one team and red accessories on another. Like,
right.
It looks a little more in place in my faction than some of the others.
Yeah.
But the base ring's a good place to go.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
see, for me, a lot of my Rebels are that desert khaki or that, you know, olive green kind of.
Yeah.
So there's always some patch that I'll paint on, you know, an arm sleeve or a hat piece or so you all know this is one unit, this is one unit. But I understand those who want to like, I want to make it look as much screen applicable as possible.
Right.
I just don't have that skill to aspire to that height. So.
Right?
I will say sometimes the model makes the painter look good.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons why I think my Harrison Dula and my spider dude from IA looks so good is because the modeling is so fantastic.
Yes.
I mean, Will has great skill, but that mall model looks great.
Yeah.
And so just know going in, look at your model before you paint to figure out where you can kind of add those highlights where the model's really helping you look very, very, very good. Some of the sculpts we've talked about, these 3D prints, we're talking about getting your own Luke. The sculpts are amazing. The things they can do now with resin printers is just fantastic.
Oh, yeah. But sometimes you have a model that's like an AT-RT and no matter how beautiful the AT-RT is, someone can still corrupt it. Someone can make it flawed.
A good place. If you've graduated out of high school and then decided you wanted to attend the Brett J. Renko Painters Institute for the Criminally Insane.
Yes.
No one really chooses to go there.
That's, they think they might.
So
Brett is the Batman villain of Legion painters.
Yeah. I did see someone on the Legion Facebook group basically say, if I saw someone who painted their models like this, not talking about Brett in particular, but
we're talking about
Brett, similar thing,
I would refuse to play them. And I had a very nasty response to that inside our group chat. I didn't put it online because I'm smarter than that.
Yeah.
But that's just horrible to me. Yeah, and I don't want to ever play that person ever. I hope they never. No.
No.
So, like, love Brett.
And he's probably a historical gamer.
Yeah, probably.
Well, yeah, at the end of the day, like, it's probably a service, like, to both parties that game doesn't get played. I don't think people would have a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's true. But.
And so. I mean, so we make fun of Brett, and I love him to death. Y'all know that. I mean, as much grief as I give him, really, it's all out of love. Because he does have a Leia that is actually a Veers model painted like Leia. and he has a Leia that is painted like Veers.
Yeah, I remember.
He does have these models that are dressed like the Avengers.
God. Poorly painted.
Yeah, poorly painted Avengers. He did paint a squad of Wookiees to look like they were Porgs.
The Porg.
Giant that one I'm a fan of, porgs. I'm not going to lie.
No, it's
that
awful.
One I'm not going to lie. Better execution, I would like to see, but the idea is solid.
No.
He has his AT-RT, he calls his chocobo, is bright yellow, and it has a yellow poof ball, cotton ball, on its head.
It's true.
I will admit, I love it. I will say I love it. Well, I've loved it every time I see it on the table.
And to be fair, I won't lie, this is something I do. I've said this in private, but I can say it now on the air. Two of my squads of Storms I traded with Brett back in the early days, back when the Corps first came out.
Mm-hmm.
And he had already primed them and painted them poorly. But they were just basically just white and either green or blue, depending on whatever the color scheme was. And they were quite rough. It was a rough painting job, I won't lie. But I threw a wash on them, and now they are some of my most complimented squads. So there's two things in that. So Brett, you did a good start there. You had a good start there. Your heart was in it. And then two, I mean, just throw a wash on your stuff and you're set. That's fine.
It really.
I enjoy asking Brett what the theme is on each squad, because he'll point and be like, "Ah, yes. Well, these are Mario, Luigi, Waluigi, and Wario. Are these four clones?"
That's a legit squad. I mean,
these four are just purple because I wanted it to be purple.
I mean, I know you think we're making this up, listeners. We're really not.
They exist.
He has a vision that is absolutely unique. And, you know, his Andy Warhol-esque pop explosion of color mesmerizes the opponent's eye. And I think he does it psychologically. Like, it causes their brain to work.
Yeah. He really is.
To reconcile what's happening. Warfare.
He really is Dali.
I mean, yeah.
That's true.
And it questions your existence, the existence of these models.
We start to bring up the war crimes for Legion, you know, the Geneva Convention of Legion. It's the Alderaan Convention.
Wake up, is round five.
It's dazzle paint to distract you.
So if you have a vision that is not in line with the average of Legion, that's perfectly okay. If you want to paint them all the stormtroopers pink and put tutus on them, I support your right to do that. I will think they're fantastic.
Model platform shoes onto all your rebels and call it the Funky Revolution.
That's right.
That would be amazing. If you
I think my favorite model from LVO last year was the Hello Kitty Darth Vader that was running around.
Oh, yes, about
that?
Absolutely.
What about that army of only Wookiees?
Yeah,
also, that was badass.
And it was officially playable because it was done so correctly. It was before silhouette.
It was clear.
Days.
It was clearly distinguishable about what everything was. Yeah. So
I do need there to be a rebel, you know, commander who looks like George Clinton, the Parliament Funkadelic, just rocking out the military.
That's a reach.
That's a reach.
All right.
Get us out of here.
Go for it, please.
All right. When Will tells me to sign off, it's time for me to sign off. And as always, thanks for listening, everybody, with whenever you bothered your paint time, your drive time. You know, you're if you're one of those cool people that can listen to podcasts at work, we appreciate you all, y'all. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slawoski, reminding you to play double rebel heavy. It's a lot of fun. It's a thing you should do.
Gross.
I'm Will Hine, reminding you to paint more minis.
I'm Tim Hannon, reminding you that I'd like to know what it's like to win again.
Never again.
I still hurt. I still
shall be there to crush you.
I still hurt,
and
Will.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you, if you paint the opponent's clones in gasoline, the match is the easy solution.
That's right. Melted models are still models.
Have a good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
We at the STABcast do not condone violence against other people's miniatures.
Suckers. The news. That's you. That's you.
Okay. I think they've gone. I don't know if y'all could hear that.
I could hear the children in the background.
Yeah, there were children shouting.
I was wondering what that was. I was like, none of us have children.
Yeah. My door is... I think there's a gap under my door. Anyway.
you should open it up loud and yell to them that I'm talking about plastic men.
I'm doing a very important podcast about plastic miniatures.
Is this where we start saying that Will has youth in his basement?
Yes.
Oh, God.